We're rolling. Welcome to class two of Being and Becoming by Fenwick Holmes with Barbara Waterhouse, through Center for Spiritual Living, Asheville. Yay. Those of you watching online, it is January 2018. And we always begin with spiritual mind treatment, so I invite you to take a breath. And let it out. And continue to breathe deeply and easily and repetitively as we let go of any and all distractions and focus within us to that place of peace, that place within us where we know, and we know that we know. And in that awareness, I know that there is only one presence and one power. It is infinite, it is absolute, it is spirit, it is all. And out of that oneness, everything comes. Out of that oneness, everyone comes. And so we are the individualized expression of spirit in form as us. Life lives us. Love loves as us. We open up to our connection with all that is. We open up to that greater awareness of who we are. And we know that whatever we need to get from this class, we get. And we use these teachings to create a life that continues to get better and better and better. And so with great gratitude for Fenwick Holmes, for Ernest Holmes, for Science of Mind, for Center for Spiritual Living Asheville, and for everyone connected with this class, I simply release this treatment into the mind of God, knowing that it is all, as together we say,
and so it is.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. Does anyone not have a book yet?
Is it the Fenwick
book? That is the Fenwick book, yes. Are there any books on the bookstore still?
Yeah, I'll do it.
Otherwise, you can download it from our website, www.cslasheville.org. It's a free download, and it's a great book. Last week, your homework was chapters 1 and 2, and I'm checking in to see if you had any questions on that.
Those chapters went over with us in class.
Pardon me?
We went over those chapters in class.
I know. There's two different ways to teach. One is to have you read the material and then we go over it after you've read it. The other way is to go over the material and then when you read it, you feel brilliant.
Yeah, I like that one.
Yeah, yeah. And that way you're reading it going, well, I know this. We just talked about that. Of course I got that. Instead of, what the heck is he talking about? I don't know this metaphysical mumbo jumbo. So my technique is always to stay a step ahead of you so that when you go to read, you're on top of it all. And for those of you that, you know, just manage to get through the week without reading, you know what's going on. Are you going to be here next week, Kathy?
I'm going to try. Moving on Tuesday. So
chances are Kathy's not going to be here next week. She's going to be here Sunday, and we're going to bring her up on stage and say goodbye to her. But those of you who have a connection with Kathy and haven't had a chance to say goodbye, she is moving to
Charlottesville,
Virginia.
I'll be back.
Still, take the moment. I always like to seize the moment and let love surface instead of thinking I'll catch it later.
Thank you.
You're wonderful here. I love you very much.
So and we'd have all you been out of there. And we'd all been
Drew.
No, I mean like if
Drew.
I just want to put out that I enjoy Fenwick a whole lot more than Ernest. I know that maybe better, but the way he puts even the beginning preface of this book, he just lays it out.
Right, right.
And then it just grows. Maybe it's a certain level of understanding, then you get it, or it just hit me.
It is that underneath that commando exterior of yours lies the heart of a poet. Mm-hmm. And Fenwick is a poet. what I was showing Chuck earlier is the book on the bookshelf, The Voice Celestial, is a poem from start to finish. They say Ernest and Fenwick wrote it. I think Fenwick wrote it and Ernest tagged along with it. Mm-hmm. But it was the last book that Ernest wrote. And if you like his poetry, it is an epic poem. And people either love it or they don't. So you're welcome to take a peek at it, The Voice Celestial, and see if it moves your heart. Drew. Jim.
I just love, I mean, this whole thing, but especially right off the bat on page 3, he's talking about a worm goes to sleep and wakes up a butterfly.
Right.
What a lovely image. And then he goes on to say, a nut, an egg, or a grain of sand hides within it the secret of life. And to explain one of them is to explain everything.
Right, right. Is there anyone who was not here last week? Great. So what we talked about last week, what we started off with, was this idea of what is life and what is the secret. If you take the grain, if you take the nut, the seed, and cut it open, you cannot find life in it. You know, you just can't. You can cut the apple over, open, and where's the tree? You can find some seeds and cut them open. You can't find that principle of life. And that principle of life is what we are. It's the same thing that heals us when we are injured or get ill. It's the same thing that brings a seed all the way through to fruition. It is something that seems so apparent, and yet it's so elusive. So what is life? And we discussed that bigger idea of life itself. Is the table alive? Are the trees alive? You went home and had a conversation with your five-year-old son, Kieran, about is the rock alive? And he was very clear that it's not alive because it doesn't have a face, and it doesn't breathe, and it doesn't drink water. So for those criteria, which is pretty common to most people, the rock is not alive. And yet, if we can set aside our preconceived ideas of what life looks like, and hold a rock. How many of us have gratitude stones? Mm-hmm. My gratitude stone is not only alive, but it talks to me. Oh. So if we can set aside our ideas, our preconceived ideas of what life is, then we can intuit and feel life all around us. Those who are hikers, you go into the forest to feel that life. I like to go to the beach to feel that life. In the arms of your lover, you feel that life. In the birth of anything, a child, a puppy, a kitten, a chicken, a plant, you feel this amazement of life, and yet there's something that is so close to us that we connect with that. So we talked about this idea of life, and that we don't have to go find it, we don't have to go get it, we don't have to shove it in us. The fact that we are alive is proof that life is what we are. And then we can go back to that. Because whatever life is living us. Whatever that principle of life is, then it already has within it everything that we need to grow and be the amazing, fulfilled being that we are meant to be. We don't have to add pieces to it along the way. That inside the seed is everything that the seed needs to grow into an oak. And so when we look at ourselves, and this is the theme in the whole book, we can start to take the pressure off. That it's not about how many classes we've taken, how many workshops we've been to, how many affirmations we've done, how long we've meditated, how much treatment work we've done. All of that is great, and it will help facilitate the living of life as us, but it's not where it's at. There is something already within us. We are already that seed. And for me, growing up, if those of you who were here yesterday, growing up in Science of Mind from 27 on, I had a lot of pressure of having to keep this schedule going. I had to read a certain amount every day. I had to have these affirmations taped up all over my house. I had to go to classes and do all of these things so that I would be okay. It was like I was pressured to be enlightened by Tuesday. You know, it's like my ego was all caught up in being egoless. Doesn't make any sense. It doesn't work. And so for us to try to run into an experience of the divine, it doesn't work. But when we can sit back and rest in the awareness that life lives as me, and because of that, I already have everything that I need to live the magnificent life I was meant to live, to have every situation heal, to have the answer to every question, the solution to every problem, to be totally loved and supported. I already have that within me. And frankly, it's more about opening up to that greater idea than it is chasing it down the road. And that was not the case when I started in this teaching. It was very much, you gotta do your denials, your affirmations, you gotta have a practitioner, you gotta do your treatment work, you gotta get on it, you gotta be vigilant on your thought. You have to stand guard on your thought 24 hours a day so you don't screw this up. Wow. You can't screw this up.
Jen. This portion, why? Because he goes on in some part, I don't know if it's chapter 2 or 3, but somewhere in here, he talks about you don't have to do denials, you don't have to do affirmations. So why?
He said it's better for you to go out with your friends and have a good time than say, oh no, I can't go because I have to put in my affirmation and denial time.
Right, so how come your center was telling you that?
Because they believed that. Nobody studied Fenwick until recently. Nobody knew Fenwick. It was all Ernest. Okay. Because Ernest had the structure of the Institute of Religious Science. You know, Ernest had the building and the board. Fenwick didn't have any of that. Fenwick hung out and wrote poetry. So no one really knew Fenwick. J. Scott Neal and Fremont was a personal student of Fenwick Holmes. And he was always talking about Fenwick. And everybody was going, yeah. No, it's Ernest. Ernest has all the books. Fenwick has 4 books. You know, Ernest has dozens of books. That's why. Karen.
Do you think that maybe people transitioning from very structured religion related to that better, that it was so structured?
I don't know. I think that all of the really good practitioners, whether it's Emma Curtis Hopkins or the people who really had demonstration down, they didn't struggle. I think it was people like me who were terrified and holding on to this for all I was worth so that I could create enough money to put gas in my car and buy some groceries and live another day. We struggled. And the reason that I had those issues in my life was that I had a belief in struggle. And I didn't have anybody tell me that struggle is your nemesis here. That when you can relax into faith and trust and accept, then the windows of heaven open. Susan.
There were so many other paths that scared me. I have to do it this way or it's not going to work. I work with Louise Hay. I worked out of the big book that said do forgiveness 70 times 70.
Right.
Every
That's
day.
A lot.
I did it. I have those journals on and on and on and on and on. And then I could say, well, it worked.
Because you did it, so you checked that off and said, okay, I can be okay now, and so you were.
And it took more than one 70 times 7. I mean, it took a lot of them, a lot of them, and a lot of them. But I was scared not to.
Right.
Because I felt desperate. I want this to work. I want me to work better than I've been working.
There was a time in my life when I didn't sleep, and I would meditate all night long. Mm-hmm. But I meditated out of fear.
Mm-hmm.
I had to meditate. I had to get this, because if I didn't, I felt I would die, that this is the only hope I had. you know, Obi-Wan, you're our only hope. Science of Mind, you're my only hope. Metaphysics, you're my only hope.
I have parts of that remaining with me that still niggling back there, that if I don't do it the right way, what's her name, who was here, great, she wrote the book, Money, and all of that. Yeah, I mean, even working out of her book.
Yeah, you got to do the CSO letter every day, every day,
and
every day.
I did, and then I didn't because then I was doing something else.
Mm-hmm.
But even with that, and not only do it, but do it correctly.
Right, right. And Abraham says, all you need is a better feeling thought.
Mm-hmm.
And so sometimes the better feeling thought is to go have another cup of coffee instead of doing an hour worth of spiritual practice. You know, and do half an hour of spiritual practice, and it's going to be okay. I'm not having to prove myself. That's why he starts off with that idea right in the front that life lives. And the very fact that you are alive is proof that spirit lives as you. And because of that, you already have everything. So when you can relax into that, I have everything, then what happens?
So you get everything.
You have everything.
Well, that's because you have to be a magnet of that. Or right. Otherwise, you're just a dead piece of wood, and that's it. You have to attract it by saying you are that to begin with.
Or just believing it. One of the things we're going to get into in this class is that the thought is an effect and not cause.
I think, well, I know for me, and I've seen others do it, it's you know, doing the repetition, the and forgiveness work is great, don't get me wrong, it's great. Affirmation is the focus. I just see them, depending on where you're at, where you, when you come to this, it's good training. It's good training.
It is.
And then you get to a point where, like, hey, you know, I don't really need all that. I need to go there. But it's
if you
really
get
good.
To that point.
It's for me, it was really good to get me on something, to keep on it, to keep with it. You know, and every day, every moment, almost every day, I'm always doing things in my head like this. And knowing that I'm one and this and that, and just everything, and things come to me out of pennies from heaven. I'm still finding pennies everywhere. but I guess I see it as training wheels, or carrying, you know, chopping wood, carry water. I mean, that focuses you step.
Spiritual practice is great. Spiritual practice done in fear is missing the boat.
Oh, yeah.
And that's what Susan and I were talking about. Mm-hmm. Meditating out of fear, that sounds very contradictory. So worrying that if I don't do this, I'm not going to have chalked up enough brownie points on the spiritual plane to be able to have my needs met is counterproductive to the process of spiritual practice. Meditating is supposed to be to have this amazing connection, to feel our oneness, to feel loved. And to meditate out of fear is missing something. And what I'm saying is that when I was taught how to do this, it came with a stick. You better do this. And I've often felt like, gee, I wish I could threaten you, you know, to get you to do what I want you to do, but we don't do that because everybody's in their perfect and right place doing exactly what they need to be doing. Everybody's on their perfect and right path and all is well. So if you want to come to class, if you don't want to come to class, if you want to come to the center, you don't come to the center, if you want to tithe, if you don't want to tithe, whatever it is you're doing is perfect for you. So I can't threaten you. That was not the case 40 years ago. It was, you better do this. If you want your life to get better, you're going to have to watch your thoughts. And if you have a thought that's counterproductive, you have to be on guard. You have to be vigilant and watch your thoughts. So we turned ourselves against ourselves. And while I think it's really important to be aware of what we're thinking and saying and feeling, to turn ourselves against ourselves, to me just doesn't feel like all the oneness and the love and the prosperity and the joy that I know is the foundation of the teaching. Kathy.
I just wanted to say the last class on Fedwick, he wrote this that stuck with me, and I use it in my treatments too. It's spirit is the life that lives us, spirit is the love that keeps us, and spirit is the wisdom that guides us.
Yes.
I love that.
The spirit is the life that lives us, the love that keeps us, mm-hmm. and the light that guides us. Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. And if we could really stand in absolute faith, we wouldn't have to do anything. I've always said the first two steps of treatment, if we got those down, we would not need to go any further. The first step is a recognition of the omnipotence of spirit. The second step is the identification that that is what I am. I am a God being made of God stuff. I am perfect, whole, and complete right here and right now. If I can get that, then I wouldn't have to do anything else. I would just live in bliss. The problem is that most of us don't get that. We've been conditioned into this idea of two-ness instead of oneness, and along with two-ness comes separation and lack and limitation and struggle and suffering, and all of that is all based in duality and two-ness. God and the devil, right and wrong, good and bad, you know, all of that stuff. If we could stay in the idea of oneness, we wouldn't have to go any farther. Mm-hmm. So I love that Fenwick gives us that. Kathy.
Some of us have taken the Joe Dispenza courses, and this is what he's actually on right now, is that you relax into the oneness.
You do.
Mm-hmm. And
you do.
It's awesome.
That's what Abraham says. That's what Ernest said just later on in his life. So let's get there sooner rather than later. My intention for 2018 is that it's easy, that everything comes to me, that all I need to do is have a passing thought, and I demonstrate that, and I notice it, and I celebrate it when that happens. That's all we ideally need to do, is awaken in the morning, and I'm not in any way encouraging you not to have spiritual practice. I just would like you to have it in joy instead of in fear. So I awaken in the morning, I set my intention for the day, I go up and get a cup of coffee because God is in the coffee. John and I talk, we do treatment work with each other, we meditate, we do treatment work for the members of this center, we do treatment work for the ministers and centers around the country, we do treatment for the whole world. You know, and it's by the time we're done, we are uplifted. Ernest said that if you are feeling stressed or tired at all after doing spiritual mind treatment, you did it wrong. And you did it wrong because you took the burden on your own shoulders. Now I have to make this happen. I have to create this. My life is my creation, which means if something is created that I don't like, I'm to blame. If I can't blame anybody else, the only one left to blame is me. No. There's no blame. There's no blame. Everything is fine. And if we created it, we can uncreate it, and we can create something new. And the best way that I know to create is to be in vibrational alignment with that which I want to have. So what do I want to have? I want to have a healthy body. I want to have happiness and love and joy and success and prosperity. So I live that as if it's already here. I don't let myself get cluttered up with facts. I don't want that. Gosh, if I'm not feeling great, I will not look at an envelope or I will not open a checkbook. Don't do that when you're not feeling well. I won't open my Charles Schwab account unless I'm singing and happy. You know, and then I look at it and go, yay! If you get an envelope from the bank or from anyone, check yourself out. Are you feeling, I don't know, God of hell? Oh, let's open this up. No. Bad idea. Get yourself in alignment with this idea that the same way that life is in the nut or the seed, life is in us. Life lives us. And the same way that the nut or the seed has everything that it needs to come into perfect form as that which it was always meant to be, is in us. And so we can lean on that instead of feeling like we've got to drag the wagon the whole way. That's pretty much what we talked about last week. Mm-hmm. Any other questions or comments, Jean?
Yeah. In my case, I think that my trouble comes from my conscious mind. And if I am aware of things in a conscious way, then I feel that I have control, you know, some sort of control over those things. But like coming here, I went, came from someplace, and I just so consciously I kept thinking, which road should I, you know, and then I suddenly thought, I'll just have to get here. And you got here. And I got here right on time.
Yes.
Yeah, without having any conscious awareness of which roads to take.
Some of us really want to be in control.
Yeah.
Yes.
We have issues. It's called control issues. Because we feel like the only way things are going to work out is if we make them work out that way.
Right.
Not realizing that there's a power and a presence within us that can work things out better than we ever dreamed. But it requires trust. Some of us have trust issues. Faith. Letting go. Surrender. And when we can do that, things work out better than we could have made it happen on our own. And that's what, I think that's what Fenwick is all about. He's trying to explain to people how to relax into this presence. And this was 1920, so people were still having the outside God of the guy up on the cloud, sin, the devil, evil, punishment, all of this stuff that he was going against and saying, no, just relax into it. There is no sin, there is no devil, there is no outside God, there is no evil, there is only that life within you that is perfect, whole, and complete right now. And so this was big news. Back in its day, it was something that was very much unheard of, and it probably at some level sacrilegious. What do you mean there's no devil? How we burn people at the stake because of the devil? You know, what do you mean there's no devil? No, it's just oneness and connectedness. Anybody else on last week's stuff? So spirit is creating and we don't have to. If we feel like we are creating, and this was a problem when we were Center for Creative Living, because in the textbook, Ernest said that man never creates, that we simply discover and use. So if we're not creating, if we're just discovering, how does that work? What are we discovering?
Everything that we have already.
Everything that we have already. Does that mean that I'm discovering this chair? That's not much of a discovery. I've been looking at it for years.
It's a realization more.
Of what?
That the chair is spirit.
That everything's one. That everything is only one.
So if yeah, I'm wanting, let's say I have a physical illness. Remember, Ernest says there's nothing to heal, only truth to be revealed. So what is it I am discovering?
You're discovering.
Am I discovering that I'm sick?
No.
Am I discovering that the person next to me sneezed on me and I caught a cold?
You're discovering that you are health and wholeness already.
I am discovering that I am health and wholeness already. I don't have to create health and wholeness from a position of being ill. This is really important. I don't say I'm sick and I need a healing. What I do is become aware of health and wholeness. And it's a whole different world. Why do you think we say, and so it is? Well, no it isn't. I've had people leave this center in my face. I can't stand it when you say, and so it is. It is not. It is not. And you just keep saying, and so it is. If I can't believe it, I'll never see it. People say, I'll believe it when I see it. No. I need to believe it. I need to know it. I need to discover that which already is before I can experience it, before I can see it. And so the idea is that even though we live in this focus point of physical form and the appearances that we're separate, I'm here, you're there, it's different, that the behind that is that we are all one. And in that oneness, everything is already perfect, whole, and complete. Everything is already health and wholeness. Everything is already prosperous and abundant. Everything is already successful. Everything is already love. Everything is already joy and happiness. And that makes some people crazy because they don't have anything to hold on to. How can you say everything is prosperity and abundance when I'm bouncing checks all over town? How can you say that? What am I just supposed to put my head in the sand and not deal with life? Well, if you're bouncing checks all over town, it may serve you to put your head in the sand and focus on what's going on inside of you. But the thing is that even though we see the world of duality, we are not limited to that. Jesus said, I'm in the world, but not of it. So there is that truth which transcends and supersedes the experiences of our life that actually feeds the manifestation of the experiences. And so when we are letting go of the pressure, when we are opening up to that realization that within us is everything that we have ever desired, that the oak tree is in the acorn, the enlightened being is in Barbara Waterhouse now. I don't have to beat myself up to try to get there. It is what I am, and I can stop running on the metaphysical hamster wheel and get off and just chill out and have some fun. That's why he said, go out with your friends. Going out with your friends is the answer to what you're doing your denials and affirmations for. I'm doing the affirmations and denials so that I can live my life in joy and have a lot of friends. Oh, come on, let's go out. Oh, no, I can't because I have to do my affirmations and denials. He's saying, no, don't do that. Go out with your friends. Have some fun. Be lifted up. Connect. Enjoy your life. And don't take everything as such a personal task on top of your shoulders. And I love that. I just love Fenwick for that. Because for me, I'm a workaholic. You know, look at what I've done in 23 years. I've done some amazing stuff, and it's taken a lot of physical work. I put those windows in. I ran electricity in these walls. I don't know how many times we painted those walls. I have done a lot of work, and I've come from a belief that says, no pain, no gain. You've got to buy your way into having an okay life. I have to do all of this stuff because I wouldn't be okay all by myself if I just showed up on Sunday. That's not true. That's neurotic. And that comes from a sense of lack instead of fullness. And so trying to beat down the lack with affirmations of fullness, Fenwick is saying just relax and enjoy the day. Yeah. Enjoy the moment. Look at the sunrise. Look at the roads. Check out the people in your life. Have some fun.
Yeah, you know, the news is a big hook for me. And what I've been doing lately is, just what you're saying, is if I see something and it hooks me, I put it down and I laugh at it.
Now?
Because it's gotten to the point where it's like, you don't have a choice, right? So you laugh at it, and then 3 days go by, and that thing isn't even...
Oh, I know.
Talked about, but now if I was to talk about it with friends and email and talk to my, it would be something, right?
It would be in your life.
But everything is that way. We've taken on a 16-year-old girl from Colombia, and they try to hook you. And I've stopped.
16-year-olds?
16-year-olds. Right? Oh, yeah. And it's really easy to be hooked. But if you don't let that hook happen, it goes away. It's like magic.
Right.
And you focus on what you love, and it's that simple.
Right. So life is always producing form. The formless is always creating form. And it's our choice what we're going to focus on and have formed in our life. And so when we watch the news and when we get all caught up and upset and drama and feed off of that, because it very much is a biological, physiological process inside of us that allows us to feed off that process of drama, not only do we get all of the wreaking havoc on our physical body from that, but we get the drama in our lives. And this 16-year-old from Columbia loves you so much, Robin, that she is happy to teach you how that works.
I'm learning quick, though.
That's how everybody is. That's how everything is in our lives. Everything is always creating. Remember we said at the end of last week, we do not live in a universe that is made. We live in a universe that is making. I don't think that was exactly the quote.
What was the last one?
We do not live in a world that has been made. We live in a world being made. We live in a universe of becoming. So our world is constantly being made. And it's going to be made one way or another, depending on what we're focused on. And if we're focused on, now I've got to go out and get three jobs and, you know, really struggle to make ends meet, the universe will show up in our lives that way. But we don't have to do that. We can rest and relax and open to this idea that we, as the seed of life, already have within us the oak tree. And that we don't have to go out and beat the doors down and find it, that whatever is ours to do will reveal itself to us. And that may be to go to work. That's okay. I'm not saying that we don't do anything. I'm saying that the way we live our life and move through life is in that awareness that everything is already here.
That's the first part of entering heaven. Once you reach that point, that's the definition of heaven. To me, is that trust.
Sure. Sure. What are we so afraid of? It's fascinating to me.
I remind myself of what I do. It's like, this sky is not falling, you know? I'm sitting in the parking lot going, no, I don't have to make that conversation right now. I can walk in and do this. And I mean, it's a really fine line of being and trying to stay conscious at the same time.
And it all has to do with how we see ourselves. If we see ourselves as separate, then we go into all the self-worth issues and the fear. If we can see ourselves as an individualized expression of the divine, perfect, whole, and complete in every way, that we already have everything that we could ever possibly desire, it's already here. Then we can move into the circumstances in our life, and instead of seeing a problem with no solution, we know that solution is here. Instead of seeing a question with no answer, we know that the answer has already been given. And so our job then is just to relax, to open, and to accept. And the biggest nemesis, I think, for that is a lack of self-worth. And that brings forth the whole idea of fear. You know, and then that's been preyed on by so many people. You have people, Catholics, walking the Stations of the Cross in Mexico City until their knees are barren and their bone and craziness, because they're afraid that if they don't do that, then they're going to somehow go to hell and burn forever. That's sick. That is sick stuff. So we want to go into this idea of we are God individualized into form as us. We are the expression of the divine. And in that, God as us has everything. It's already done. It's already done. And I don't want to get into a bunch of Jesus quotes, but there are a lot of Jesus quotes that support that. So what we want to do is take a breath and relax. Feel the connection. Know that everything has already worked out, and then watch it work out. And every time it does that, acknowledge it. Wow, I thought, and here it is. I didn't do 70 times 7. I didn't do journals of it. I didn't spend hours on it. I just thought, and there it is. And that's where I want to get. And I've spent 40 years in this teaching doing affirmations and doing treatments and doing denials and working, working, working. And I think that we get farther this way than we ever do by beating ourselves and saying, hurry up, hurry up, hurry up. Because where are we going? There's only here, there's only now, it's already done. And all we need to do is chill out and open up to it and watch the things show up in our lives. Does that make sense, Kathy?
Yeah, the interesting thing that I love about the teaching is it might take a while to get into your head, but if you notice and you believe it, you come back quicker and quicker.
Yes.
Like if you lose it, you are coming back quicker.
Right, if you freak out,
right.
It's different.
Yeah.
In my first few decades, even after I was assigned to my minister, I freaked out so often that it was normal. And then when you stop freaking out all the time, you notice when you're freaked out. Wait a minute, what's going on? I'm yelling, I'm throwing a temper tantrum, my heart is pounding, I'm sweating. What's happened? Oh, right, I'm freaking out. I don't need to freak out anymore. And then you can bring yourself back.
Right.
Yeah.
Your second thought. Like
your
you
second
said.
Thought. Yes.
Have
yes.
a second thought. I love
yes.
That.
So he says, all great healing is done on the basis of this realization that the work is being done for us. And that was the language of his day. I wouldn't even use being done for us because that sounds like someone is doing something for us. It's already done. It has already happened. Just like this cough syrup and cough drop that I'm going to give Kelly when she comes out. It's already done. Because even when you just have a passing thought, it manifests. Quantum physics says you cannot have a thought without the thing. That if you had a thought without the thing, then you would have a hole in the universe and the time-space continuum would not hold together. So every time you think of something, it exists at some level. And as you continue to think about it, it manifests into form. Sometimes really, really fast, call it a miracle. Sometimes slower, we call it process. Doesn't matter. You're manifesting all the time. The universe is not already made. Your life is not already made. It's being made constantly. And there is a presence and a power within you that is going to create. It's just up to you how you focus that creation. So rather than being afraid of it, rather than fighting it, rather than thinking that, oh my gosh, I hope I have the spiritual chutzpah to pull this off. Know that you don't even have to pull it off. It's already here. It's already done. No struggle, just no. So he says, denials and affirmations are not creative. What in the world does that mean? I thought that we were supposed to do denials and affirmations that our word creates. Change your thought, change your life. Kelly, those are for you. Change your thinking, change your life. And now he's saying that the thoughts of denials and affirmations are not creative. Mm-hmm. What the heck does that mean?
Well, it's just like you said before, it's supposed to go out and feel the joy and have fun.
Well, what about thoughts of joy are not creative? But don't mean that's sacrilege, signs of my sacrilege. Even feelings. Thoughts and feelings are not creative. Everybody take a deep breath.
Meaning they're already in us. They're already there.
Thoughts and feelings are not cause. Thoughts and feelings are effects. What really is creative?
Spirit.
Spirit is creative. Fenwick says creative mind is creative, not creative thought. That our thoughts direct mind, and mind does the creating. Let's just check out the teaching symbol. So this would be law, whoops. I'm spelling love. Don't love again. Law and creative mind. feelings, don't do the creating. They direct. They're very important. They direct, but they don't create. If you think that thoughts and feelings create, then the pressure is on the thinker and the feeler. You had better think the right thoughts, because you're going to harness the power of the universe to wreak havoc in your life if you think the wrong thoughts. No, this is what creates. You don't have to do it. All you have to do is direct it. And when you direct it, then it just shows up. That's why you can have a passing thought and have something wonderful show up in your life. Drew.
Thank you for that, because that is literally the acorn of the whole thing. Right there. It just guides it. Your thoughts and feelings guide it, and it just creates.
And you need to guide it, but it's not that big of a deal. Don't get all freaked out about it. Like Kathy said, if you have one thought that's totally crazy, have another thought. Just have a different thought.
How do you guide it?
With your awareness. Who thinks about the thought that you think?
Me.
That's the way you guide it.
But sometimes something comes up and you don't think about it or do
you
anything.
You don't choose to think
so
about it. Robin doesn't choose to think about the thought that just went through his synaptic process. That's why it's important to be aware. Be self-aware. But not with all the pressure. There is a thinker behind the thought. You use your thoughts to direct law. You use your feelings to direct law. You set your intentions to direct law. You visualize to direct law. But the law is what creates. And according to quantum physics, whatever you're thinking about and setting your intention about already exists. All you're doing is like tractor beaming it into your life. You don't have to create the spaceship out there. All you do is put your tractor beam on it and say, ah, there's more good for me in this life. There's more joy, more abundance, more health, more wholeness, more energy, more time. I'm a big one on creating time. You can bend time, you can manifest more time, or you can completely lose lots and lots of time, depending on how you choose to think. But it is you choosing to think, and then it is the law, the creative mind, that brings that thought into form. Does that make sense? Laura.
So can you create anything that you haven't thought?
Sure, because you have subconscious thoughts all the time. You have race thought. The connections that we are, because we are all one, brings into our experience love and joy and prosperity and all of that wonderful stuff, but it also brings in all the crazies. So there's a basic race belief in duality, in lack, in struggle, in danger. You know, we're wired with that limbic brain for danger, and there are lots of people living that out in the world. So yes, you can create all kinds of things. That's why it's important to be conscious of what your thoughts are, but you are not your thoughts. People think that they are their thoughts. You're not your thoughts. You are way bigger than your thoughts. You're not your body. Most of us have that down pretty well. You're way bigger than your body. You're not your feelings. Oh, I couldn't help it. Sure you could. I just reacted. Well, that was a choice to feel that feeling. Did that make sense, Laura?
So it's subconscious thought or conscious. Either way, some thought is creating.
Always. Well, some thought is directing law or mind to create. You're steering with your thought, but you're not the motor. But it will take you wherever you want to go. And many of us have race cars going on right now. Karen, Jane?
I have this giant question mark over my head right now. I think I'm right on the edge of really understanding something bigger than I have before. So how I relate to most things is when I'm doing art, I don't think at all. I just create. Okay, how does that fit into that paradigm?
I'm not talking about your personal creativity.
Okay.
I'm talking about the creative force of life.
The spirit brings, behind it?
I'm talking about that energy that actually brings form into our lives. Not that you take a bunch of form and put it together in a unique way and then you have another thing that you created. No, I'm not talking about that. That's your personal creativity.
Okay.
I'm talking about the creative process that is behind all of time and space, that actually brings form into manifestation in our lives.
Got it.
Yeah, that's not creativity, that's creative. And what I'm saying is that a lot of people in science of mind think, well, okay, now my thought is creating this. No, your thought is directing creative mind. Take a break. Creative mind has it. I used to say to myself, watching sunrises, okay, spirit, you handled the sunrise. You handled the rotation of the earth and the spinning of the planets and gravity and all of that. Oh, but what? Now you can't handle this? You can't handle a bill? You can't handle a meeting? You can't handle a double booking on your calendar? Come on. So I can turn that over. One of my favorite quotes in the Science of Mind textbook, and I have a number of them, but this is one of them, is Ernest says, place your burden on the altar of love to be consumed by the fires of faith in the living God. And what he's saying is that there is a power bigger than you think you are that you can turn something over to, and it will handle it. And that's what Fenwick is saying in this book, that there is a presence and a power that is already you, that you are evidence of it by your very beingness. It is the tree, the oak tree in the acorn. It's already done. It's already handled. It's already here. If you can think it, creative mind already has manifested it. It's not a time thing. We're operating outside of time and space. Time and space is down here. It's the space-time continuum. It's down here in form and body. That which we are is not in time and space. And so we're operating from a different level. And we're setting this thing that Fenwick is calling creative mind in motion, and it must be manifested already before you even get to any realm of time and space. Whatever it is you're thinking about, and that's why it's important not to watch the news, because you don't want to think those thoughts. It manifests something, somewhere. And so we want to be clear about how we're directing this race car of creative mind as we go flying. You know, by the time we're in time and space, we're at 1,000 miles an hour. We want to be clear about it. If we thought something we don't want to experience, think another thought. Oh, but that was a really big thought I thought. Had a lot of emotion too. It doesn't matter. Take a deep breath. Have a happy thought. Go out for a walk. Go have some fun. And watch how everything just unfolds. Jane and then Jenny.
Well, just having trouble understanding.
You like trouble, don't you? You have troubles. You have trouble understanding. I think you are much clearer than you think.
Part of me is. Well,
yeah, exactly. Let's talk to that part.
I'd like to get more access to that part. And it's, there's so many closed doors. So, but what I'm thinking is, what you're saying is that we do not create our thoughts. Is that what you're saying?
No, I'm saying that you do create your thoughts. Your thoughts are not the point of creation. You are. You are not your thoughts. Does that make sense?
I am.
Did you used to think differently?
Well, I can't remember.
Sure you can. Did you ever think differently about anything?
About anything?
Yes.
Yeah, well,
okay, so that means that you can have a thought, one thought one day, and another thought another day.
After a learning experience.
Yeah, yeah. So you learned, you grew, you expanded.
As
right.
Sadko goes on, you learn more things, and then you can...
Right, the point here is Jane had a thought, and then Jane had a different thought.
Yeah.
That's the key. You can have a different thought. And if you have a different thought, you are setting this amazing thing called creative mind or law in motion that can manifest anything, can manifest universes and galaxies and all of this amazing stuff. And what do you want? You want the deal to go through. It can handle that. All you're doing is opening up to accepting that which is already there. Life is going, here, take this. It's right here. And you go, no, I have to work harder for it. I have to do more. I have to try harder. I'm not good enough just to take it. You are the acorn that already has the oak. The acorn doesn't stress about whether or not it's really got the oak. It's got the oak. You already have that presence of the divine in you and the life that corresponds to that. Jim.
Okay, so I thought the first part of our teaching symbol is first progress.
No, only in the absolute. You have different teaching symbols. One is the absolute, one is the relative.
Okay. All right, so thoughts and feelings are not first cause. So that's what I'm getting.
Well, I wouldn't use the teaching symbol to
try to understand thoughts and feelings.
Right, okay. Right. Okay. I would do it differently.
Okay.
Because you're right, I've got this in as if it's cause. And I just said thoughts and feelings are not cause. What I was showing was creative mind. So, what you have is self, and then you have thought, feelings, and then you have manifestation. There is the thinker behind the thought. That's why you can think about what you think about. If you were your thoughts, you could only think. You couldn't think about what you think about. You couldn't choose to think something differently. So get to know you. You are not your thoughts. You're not your feelings. You have them. But if you want to be in control of something, be in control of your awareness. Of how you're doing. How happy am I being? How joyous am I feeling? How prosperous am I living? How am I doing with the beauty of life? And then think those thoughts. And what will happen is life brings that into your experience. And my experience has been that if I don't micromanage the creative process of the universe, I get better stuff. It's easier, it's happier, it's bigger than I thought it was, because my need to micromanage came from a lack of self-worth that I couldn't trust the universe to show up like I wanted it. And so that lack of self-worth demonstrated as lack of worth. So what I got was little instead of big. Michelle.
I'm trying to figure out, is there a difference between intuition and manifesting something?
Yes.
Okay, because I'm thinking of this, an experience I had where I was at a park with Kieran when he was two, and he was near a fence, and he was watching some cars go by, and I thought, and now I'm trying to think, did I manifest this by thinking it? But I thought, I don't like him standing that close to a fence where there's cars, so I picked him up, and I was like, it's time to go anyways, let's just go. So we're walking away, and a car came through the fence, crashed through the fence.
Yeah, no, you didn't create that. Because we live outside of time and space, you had an awareness of danger to your child. Very common thing for mothers to have.
And not mom's intuition. Or...
Right, and so you went and grabbed your kid, and then the car came through. You didn't create that. You were aware of that happening.
Mm-hmm.
And so you took action so that you still have Kieran.
So there's a difference then.
Okay. Yes, yes. And people can do that. That gets into the very close to the blame idea. Well, if I'm responsible for everything in my life, am I to blame? No. No, life is a gift of joy and happiness and love and adventure. Mm-hmm. And it's our job to live it that way. And the more we live it that way, the more great things happen to us, because that's what we're living. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Great, let's take a break. Rolling, rolling, rolling.
Rolling, rolling, rolling.
So, in this idea of things are thoughts, usually we hear thoughts are things. So you think a thought and a thing happens. And what Fenwick is saying is that things are thoughts. So as you look at your life, everything that you see is a thought. The table is not really a table. The table is a thought of a table. Chuck is a thought of Chuck.
So is it like collective consciousness then is making that thing?
Stay with me. So in the idea of spirit creating, then spirit thinks a thought and then becomes the thought that spirit thought. So spirit thinks a thought of Chuck and becomes the thought of Chuck. Now think about that in your own life. Can you see where you thought a thought? But then this is where it's a little different. And then you became that thought. So you became, you're not attracting, you became your car, your relationship, your spouse, your money, your body, your walk in the park, whatever it was, you became that. Because the truth is that through this idea of oneness, you have to be everything and everyone in your life. They cannot be separate from you. So I am a thought of Chuck, and Chuck becomes that in my life. And if Chuck in my life is wonderful and loving and close, I became Chuck as wonderful and loving and close. If Chuck, like some of my previous husbands, if I thought a thought of someone that was like my previous husbands over here, and they were not loving and kind and close, they were dirty, rotten, racket fratchets that were out to totally screw me over, I became that as them. Because the most amazing thing happened with my first husband is when he was in a relationship with someone else, he was a different person.
Yeah.
Because she became him as much more loving and supportive than I ever did. So this is really important, because you are thinking of everything in your life, the amount of money in your pocket, the way your body feels, the experiences that you have during the day. And you become that. They're not separate and you're not attracting them to you. You are becoming that. I have become you, the best students in the world, getting these subtle nuances of how to live a spiritual life, how to be connected, how to be supportive, how to be just happy. I have become you. You have become me. And hats off to you. You have become a really great teacher so that you can experience this. But the things in your life that are not seemingly so great, you have become that. And so it allows you to look at yourself and say, what part of me was just out to get me and screw me over? Well, there were definitely a big part of me that was out to do that, and that's what I manifested. But then, to further disempower myself, I blamed that person as if they had power over me and were the boss of me and ruled me, so that I continued to be a victim and continued to live my life at effect. Instead of saying, Barbara, you not only created that, you manifested yourself as that. That is me. Take a deep breath. Donald Trump is you. What is going on within ourselves that is limited and judgmental and all of those other things? And what is going on inside of us that is creating business and jobs in a rocking economy? So there's all of that stuff that's happening. As we are more compassionate with the people in our lives and with ourselves, we will find that, yes, even President Trump demonstrates with more compassion. Our Senate, our legislature demonstrates with more compassion, with the more compassion that we give out. Now, someone else may have a president that is not compassionate, but that's them. I want my life to be filled with all of the great things in me, which means as soon as I see something that pushes my button, I gotta look inside of myself and say, at what level do I still harbor those kinds of thoughts? And this is where I usually lose people, because they still want to have the right to righteous judgment, and there is no such thing. Susan.
So for me, putting this together is the question, what part of me is reflected in her, him, it, the situation?
Right.
And as wonderful, as positive or as negative as it is, what I'm looking at, I know I'm looking at an aspect of myself.
Exactly, because there is only you in the oneness
right.
of it all.
And that's the teacher for me to either embrace that part that I just saw or say, all right, we need some shaping up here.
Right, right. And the only place that we can work is inside of ourselves.
Inside job.
Right.
Okay.
That's the bitter pill that goes along with, yes, you can have all the money you can spend. You can have a body that just keeps getting younger and younger. You can have people that are your soulmate. You can have more joy than you ever thought possible.
Yeah.
And it's all in you. Robin.
Is there a limit to outside of you? Is like,
nope.
You say the whole
nope.
world? And
nope.
There's kids dying and being beaten. I mean, there's
all
some part of you that's
part of
enough.
You.
That's
it's
a lot
not,
of pressure.
No, and that's the thing. Don't go to pressure. Go to love. Do something, not nothing. If you're concerned about children who are being abused, do something. If you're concerned about starvation, do something.
But that's internal. It doesn't mean go out and try to fix everything. That's, you said it was internal.
It is internal. Sometimes for me, it helps if I do something. But it's all me. What am I going to focus on? At the realm of quantum, it is that my reality is created by my observation in nanoseconds, period, right now. All of my reality. And if we are all individualized expressions of the divine, perfect, whole, and complete, then everybody is individualized expressions of the divine, perfect, whole, and complete. I remember when I heard Abraham say, well, what about the cows that are being slaughtered? And Abraham said, these animals that have presented themselves on planet Earth for the purpose of providing food go forth into their transition with endless joy. And I said, well, I've seen movies about it. It doesn't look joyous to me. And yet from that higher vantage, there is great joy with that. So which one do I want to pick? Do I want to pick the one about all the horrible things that are happening? Or do I want to pick the idea that at a spiritual level, these beings, which is what cows are going forth with joy? It's my choice what I pick. And there are a lot of people who look for their injustice gatherers of all kinds, and they spend their life looking for what's wrong because they have a right to be judgmental about that. Everything is one, God is all there is, except right here, which is just wrong, wrong, wrong. And if you do that, then you're going to become that in your life. And so it's a lot, but don't feel pressure from it. Take that pressure and turn it over.
Well, it gets back to being hooked, right?
Yeah.
What you're focusing on, and it seems like you're turning away from it, but you're really not. When you're focusing on the good, yet it dissolves. It's like you're dissolving it, that, right?
It goes you're dissolving away. What?
The what you think is bad is going to go away if you concentrate on good.
I think so.
Right. That's basically.
I would rather live as a child and not know and be in joy. And people say, oh, Barbara, that's terrible. You have social responsibility. I have spiritual responsibility to me. And by taking care of that, it manifests in my whole world. So there was Robin, there was somebody else. Hold on, no. Before you, there was Drew, and then Steve, and then Jay. Drew.
Oh. Can you go back over the thoughts and the thinking and thought, and then my inner being completely got that, but my...
Who thinks, Drew? What did you just think about?
No,
don't paraphrase it. Answer me. What did you just think about?
I thought about how...
Okay, that's it. Who thought? Who thought that thought about what you thought?
My inner being.
So that is before your thought. Rational emotive therapy. You always make a decision on what to think. And you always have a thought before you have a
feeling. And when I was trying to grasp it, my inner being was like, I got this. And that's why when you transcend a thing. But when you're thinking and you understand that, you don't have to transcend it because you're not really invested in the quote-unquote
Think about what you think about.
Yeah.
That's all. Think about what you think about. Is this really what you want to think about? All the doom and gloom and going to hell in a handbasket? Or do you want to think about all the joy in life, all the beauty in life? Think about what you're thinking about. There is a thinker behind the thoughts, Drew, and that's the important part of it.
Because you can watch your thoughts.
You can watch your thoughts. So many people think their thoughts own them. I have no control over my thoughts. I have no control over my feelings. Of course you do. I think the phrase after that is your honor.
I don't know how to pronounce this, but something Dr. Joe Vitale talks about all the time is Opa Nopa, is it Hawaiian?
Right, the forgiveness thing.
Yeah, how does that play
in? I don't know. You know, I'm married to a guy who wrote a book about not being sorry. And part of that is being sorry. But I think that anything that we can do to connect is better than doing something that separates. Blame separates, shame separates, anger separates, fear separates. So anything that we can do to connect is going to be better for ourselves and our world that we are becoming. Okay?
Jane was next.
Jane and then Kathy.
I create happy worlds all the time that are filled with humor and laughter and this and that, but they're fantasies.
That's okay. Live in them. This is a fantasy.
No, it's not good to walk around talking to yourself.
I don't know. People just think you have an earbud in.
Yeah. That's right.
I would rather live in a fantasy of joy than a reality of tragedy.
God.
You know, Viktor Frankl spent all that time in the concentration camps. He walked around Europe, three steps at a time. He said they could beat me, they could starve me, they could torture me, but they couldn't take away my thoughts.
Yeah. Ah, so he thought he had kind of fantasies in his concentration.
Yes, yes. Don't make yourself wrong. Get a pen and write them down. You're a writer. Kathy?
I was just thinking, I like to know what I want to feel, and I work backwards. So if I want to feel, I want to feel happy. So if I have a thought that's not for the happiness, I try to change that thought. But I try to go backwards. But you were saying you always have a thought before a feeling.
We do. We always have a thought before a feeling. You're thinking about the feeling that you want to feel and going backwards. It's very much a thought process.
Okay.
Right?
Yeah. Okay.
It's a good thought process.
Yeah.
You're having an awareness. Oh my gosh, I'm feeling something I don't really want to feel. I want to feel something different.
Right.
So I'm going to work on feeling that feeling that's different. Well, you thought all that through before you had the feeling.
That's pretty cool, huh?
Yeah. So question that Fenwick gives us is, if everything in our life is a perception of us, and he's doing 1920 science, so you got to give him a little bit of space, that when I see something, I'm actually seeing a bunch of vibrations, and my optic nerve takes that vibration to my brain, and my brain creates a picture. And I have long thought that we all see different things.
Mm-hmm.
It happened as soon as I found out I was colorblind. I went through that colorblind test as a kid. I saw like 2 out of 10 of the things on it. And they said that there's something switched around in the rods and cones of my eyes. And I started looking at people going, well, how do their rods and cones work? That was before I even knew that you don't see anything. That what you do is take a vibration and your brain completely translates it. What I see and what you see may be worlds apart.
Yeah.
So since we are getting the experiences of our life through our perception of them, he's asking, if you don't perceive something, does it actually exist? You know, it's kind of that if a tree falls in the forest and no one's there to see it, did it really happen? What do you think? This is important. What do you think? Anna.
This is like I'm using the power of our thought.
Power of what?
Of what we're thinking.
Yes. So if you don't think it, does it exist? So what do you think? If you don't perceive something, if it doesn't register in you, and you are becoming everything in your life, and you didn't perceive it, does it ever exist?
Not
in your experience.
No.
Not fully.
I'm thinking in terms of like before we thought, kind of thought about maybe there was a source of electricity existing.
But until we perceived it, we never had it in our experience. So it may have existed in potential, but it never existed in form. It takes our perception for something to manifest in form in our life.
And create.
And to create it, yes.
And is that also connected with what you've talked about before, is that once you do perceive it, it exists.
Once you perceive it, simultaneous to that perception, it must exist. Otherwise, there's an empty space in the infinite, and that's impossible. So if you can think it consciously, subconsciously, race consciously, if you can think it, it must exist at some level. May not be in your driveway yet, but it exists. So the pressure is off for you to create it. But that's why we say turn away from the condition. Why do you want to turn away from the condition?
Because you're giving it energy.
You're giving it energy. You're actually bringing it to life in your life by focusing on it, by thinking about it, by talking about it. You're bringing it forth. You're becoming that in your life. And then you live it. And maybe when you could have had a perfectly nice person to be married with, you didn't. But somebody else did. That's fascinating to me. Breezy.
Do you remember the story about the Native Americans could not see the ships that were off the
coast? I've heard the story. I don't know if it's true or not, but it's a fascinating story.
I was just thinking about that concept that you were talking about.
That when the when Christopher Columbus's ships came to America, the Native people couldn't see it, is the story.
Oh.
No one was there taking notes. And that it took the shaman to go out there and notice that the waves were different in certain areas and open up to the idea that something was there. And then all of a sudden, they could see the ships. And then once the shaman could see the ships, then they told the other people the ships were there and they could see the ships. It's a lovely story. You know, I don't know if it's true.
Yeah.
But I'm sure that there are things like peace on earth that a lot of us are looking at, and some people are going, nah, it's nothing there, nothing there. And we're going, yeah, yeah, look, 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 there's peace, possibility of safety, possibility of love, possibility of food, possibility of health. That's there. And other people are going, nah, yeah, not there.
It's the emperor's new clothes.
Pardon me?
It's the emperor's new clothes.
Right.
Why would you say possibility?
At some level, because everything exists in possibility and probability, taking only so long as to collapse into form and show up in our lives.
A potentiality.
Right. So if I'm opening up to my new sports car, and I'm knowing my, as soon as I open up to an idea of the new sports car, it exists. It's not in my driveway yet. Doesn't mean it doesn't exist. If I think, well, it's not in my driveway, I need to do some more work on it, then I'm putting the pressure on me to make it happen. Instead of just knowing that it's manifesting in my life, it's here, I know it's here, because I can think it, it's here, and I'm becoming the me that has the sports car.
Instead of making it happen.
Because a lot of people say, well, I visualized it. Where is it? It's not here yet. Well, as soon as you go to it's not here yet, it's not here yet. So what we want to do is be open to the manifestation of our heart's desire, whatever that is, and know that it is here. That's why we say, and so it is. Because and so it is means that it's here. Laura.
But aren't you saying for you, the peace already here, because that's what
yes
you're like, I already know the world's peaceful.
Yes,
not everyone else's,
right? That's their world. You know, this space-time continuum thing, this universe layer of time and space, they say there are uncountable universe layers on top of each other. Is it possible that each one of us lives in our own universe layer, and that each one of us experiences our world uniquely?
Yes.
Yeah, so I want to get into that universe layer that is peace and prosperity and love and joy for all.
Isn't that what Roddenberry was trying to teach us with that whole series?
What series?
Star Trek.
Oh, I don't know.
Richard Bach.
There are parallel universes. There are parallel classes happening right here simultaneously, one for each of us. That's why people can come to this center and say they're all a bunch of quacks. Or, all they want is my money. Or, I read the little card and nothing happened. You know? Or, I'm going to come here and pick up chicks. Or I'm going to come here and sign people up for my multi-level marketing. People have all kinds of different centers for spiritual living. Everybody gets to have their own. And so if you get to have your own world, not in the Mormon, you have to spend eternity with your biological family. But if you get to have your own world, then might not you want to see the infinite possibilities to have it be the way you want it? And you do that by observing it, by perceiving it, by recognizing it, by knowing it. And that's what quantum physics says. Quantum physics says that everything exists in potential and possibility, awaiting only someone's focus. And once you focus on it, it collapses into form. We're doing it. The universe is, the world is not made. The world is being made. It's being made by spirit as us, manifesting itself as everything in our world. And so it can be changed in a moment. It's easier to change our world if we are not focused in fear and if we're not beating ourselves up.
Yeah.
Who had their hand up? Drew.
This is some high level mystic stuff here. I'm glad I created you to remind me.
That's right, baby.
Some serious
She's
stuff.
Making a face tonight.
Deep, baby.
Deep.
Well, it goes back to the idea of turn away from the condition and focus on what you want. Become the change you want to see. Embody that within yourself and watch it manifest on the outside. Jim?
You said quantum mechanics says something is awaiting only for our focus.
Everything exists in possibility and probability. Okay. Awaiting, and it's quantum physics. I don't really know what quantum mechanics are. Awaiting only the observer, the observation of that, and then it collapses into form.
Okay.
It's like everything is ready. Everything that possibly ever could be is ready, and all any of us have to do is become aware of it, and it collapses into form. This whole idea that it's already manifested, that we don't have to go out and get it, that there is a health and a wholeness within our physical bodies, doesn't matter how sick we are, it is here. There is an abundance and prosperity in our lives, doesn't matter how broke we are, it is here. There is success and freedom and love and joy, and that is a given. That is an absolute. It is here. We're not going out and trying to find it. We're not trying to barter for it. We're not trying to buy it. It's already here. And so that's what we focus on. And the pressure is off if you've already got it. You know, whatever it is you're looking to manifest, you've already got it. You go, oh, thank God I've already got it. Well, pressure's off. Once you thought it, you have it.
Do you have to just recognize it?
Sure, just recognize it. Clarity, Jane.
Yeah.
That's it. I've seen you crystal clear.
Mm-hmm.
Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
And you're right, that's some high-level mystical stuff. High-level mystical stuff. But what it allows us to do is to relax into the awareness that each of us is an individualization of the presence of the divine, that we are the acorn and we already are the oak tree. Simply by us being alive, the life that is within us, mystical, magical, wonderful, already is perfect, whole, and complete. No missing parts. Nothing that we have to scramble to try to fix. We are not broken. It is simply the awareness of the truth that manifests. And the best manifestors I've ever seen are practitioners who are not, they just live in that awareness that it's already done. It's already here. Everything has already happened. And it's like, that's all it takes. And then the miracle happens. And that's what we want to do. We want to be clear without fear about who we are and what the world is about. My world is about amazing people coming out on a Monday night to be able to get who they are in the world. That's what my world is about. And the clearer I am about who I am, the clearer my manifestation as you is. Some of my peers, you know, they start complaining about their people, and I look at them and go, you're not a very good teacher, are you? This is why some of them don't like me. If you were here that Wednesday night, you heard me lecture them. It's up to me to be the best me that I can be and then you manifest as the best you that you can be. If I'm surrounded by people who are not doing well, that's me. And that's for you too. If you're surrounded by people in your life that steal from you, that lie to you, that cheat you, that are out to get you, that's all you. And so it's best to go within and get clear about who you are. You are the acorn that has the oak tree. You are already the oak tree, whether it's in your driveway or not. You're already the oak tree. And since there's no time and space, you are both the acorn and the oak tree at the same time. Isn't that cool? So if you look at yourself and all you see is an oak tree, just look until you see, if you look at yourself and all you see is an acorn, just look at yourself until you see the oak tree. There's no time and space. Be here now, Ram Dass. It's already done. It's already here. Everything. We've already surmounted the problem. We've already gone through whatever it is we think we're going through. It already happened. It already worked out. So why are we sweating it? Why are we sitting up at night worried about things? That's a lack of awareness of who we are. Who are you but the individualized perfection of all that is as you? And we do the same thing in our lives. We become our life. And so, what is it Ernest says that, now I've got myself stuck. Spirit, on the absolute level, I won't try to paraphrase, creates worlds. And we, on the relative level, create our world and people it with living things, I think he said. So whether it's dogs and cats and horses and rabbits and people, we are creating our world in the same way that on an absolute level, all that is creating universes and galaxies and planets and all of that. It's the same process. And then we become that which we create, the same way as spirit has become us. You know, it's really kind of a cool thing to think that you are not even a God being, because that has a connotation of separation, like there's one God being and two God beings. There's only one being. It has many different faces, but it's all the same. Otherwise, we would go back to duality and two-ness. There's only one. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. This is a lot of heady stuff for you. It is. But in it lies the freedom to have your life be any way you want it. Rob?
One thing I've been doing lately is I go on Craigslist, and I'll dream up something crazy. A service at a crazy price. And within a week or two, I'll get a call. Mm-hmm. And it's just what you're saying. It's like something I just wouldn't think would happen that would be a dream. And lately it's been happening. And I figured, why not just play, you know? And I think everybody should try it. Just do something. You know, I'm going to sell this pen for $1,000. It doesn't matter what it is, but something hopefully you love to do. And I'm getting calls. Mm-hmm. And it's like, are you kidding me? Really? You want that service for that? But you're walking into what, like you're saying, you are.
Ernest's nickname was happy. Be happy. And watch how the universe brings into form things that reflect that happiness. And watch yourself as you notice them and accept them. And understand that it's you being happy and becoming happiness on the outside. True.
Every once in a while I do a similar thing. Yeah, I don't stay with Facebook because it's just I have a couple of groups in it. But what's funny was I would sit there every once in a while and I'm thinking like, okay. And I look at the feed and I'm thinking, oh, these happy, wonderful thoughts, and just scroll like that. Kittens and rainbows. Oh, that's really cool. The people were saved and blah, blah, blah. And then I go, oh, dark and gloom. And then, oh, my God, it's dark and gloom. And then you go back and forth. I want kittens and rainbows, and there's kittens and rainbows and puppy dogs and everything. And it's like, it changes before your eyes. It's like, oh, wait a minute.
Sure, because whatever you are looking for, you will find.
Or it's just here, and I'm doing it, and I'm like, I'm proving myself that I know what I'm going to do. Duh, my inner being is going, does that make you happy?
Whatever you are looking for, you will find. Because you become what you are looking for. So you have to find it because you just became it.
That's just too funny. It's just like pennies.
Really? Anybody else? Any other questions or comments? Laura.
So it made sense to me when I read something that humans wouldn't perceive the color green until like, I don't know, 200 years ago or something. And I was like, wow, we couldn't see the color green. Like, we saw green as always blue. So when you were talking about, anyways, that just, oh, it's been there all along, we humans thought all the trees were blue.
One thing that I pondered as a child is that when I look at a color, my colors are red and green. When I look at red, do I see the same red that other people see? Because according to the book with the dots, I don't. And when I see green, is that the same green that other people see? Because according to the book with the dots, I don't. So when I look out at the beautiful green trees, I know that other people are seeing a different tree than I do. Yeah. It all just fed into my feeling like, I don't even know why I'm on this planet. I feel so weird. But you're right. And who knows what we're going to see in the future? Maybe we'll get to where we see the auras and the rainbow colors and the vibrations and all of that. Maybe we'll just be light beings moving through a world of light. Cool. Who knows?
Karen? You know the expression, seeing through rose-colored glasses? Uh-huh. I discovered that that's what I do. I mean, when I look at clouds, I'll go, look at those purple clouds. And everybody goes, where? Because I can't even imagine.
You get to have purple clouds.
Yeah. And I think being an artist, I really do know that I look at the same thing and see something different. Like you said, from a child, it's always been that way, where I assume everybody else can see that. And after a while.
We look at a world and see peace. We look at a world and see love. We look at a world and see prosperity and health and wholeness. And not everybody does that. But that's their absolute right. They're using the same creative process that we are. We have just learned to think about what we think about, to choose how we want to see the world, and to choose how we want to be. That if we put out love, we're going to get love back. If we put out prosperity, we're going to get prosperity back. If we put out health, we're going to get health back. We've learned that. And so we practice that. But it takes away all sense of victimization, all sense of blame and powerlessness, as if anybody is outside of us that can do anything to us. There is no outside of us. If we are becoming our world, then there is only us. And if something's happening that we don't like, the only place to look is inside of ourselves. Clean it up, shift it, and then watch the outside change, but without pressure, without blame, without stress. It's like, are you stressed out as to whether or not the earth is going to keep spinning tonight?
Nope.
No, nobody here is stressed out about that. It's the same creative process. You know that we're going to have a beautiful sunrise in the morning, even if it's raining.
Yep.
And we can know that we're experiencing prosperity and health and love and joy and happiness. Because that's just the way that it is. It came with us being alive. It came with the life that we are. And that's why he started off the book with that idea. Okay? Any other questions or comments before we close? Good job, Drew.
I'm impressed that for 1920s, I'm impressed that they didn't get tarred and feathered at some point.
Yeah.
Brilliant stuff, though. Brilliant.
That wasn't their reality.
Yeah.
Right, that wasn't their reality. They were putting out too much love, becoming love. They opened up a home to have people with tuberculosis come and do healing treatment on them. You know, they weren't afraid of it. They just put out the love, became the love, lived the love, and got back the love. No tarring, no feathering. The next two chapters, 3 and 4 for next week. Take out what you're going to give. And what I want you to do, in addition to the reading, is I want you to notice the manifestations in your life, especially the ones that you just had a little thought about, okay? The little thoughts that manifest. Watch them, notice them, anchor them in your awareness. Okay?
Okay.
You two have a deal?
Okay.
Have a deal.
Good, 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 good. And so what I know is that spirit made manifest, individualized as us, contains all of the abundance, all of the beauty, and all of the joy of all of life. I know that we open our awareness to that beauty, that joy, and that abundance right here and right now. And I know that as we give our gift this evening, we give it with joy, abundance, and beauty. And that goes with our gift. I know that as we focus on these things, our life becomes them. So we demonstrate as ourselves abundance in every area, beauty all around us, and joy throughout our life. That is the truth of us now. And I know that as we give this gift tonight, each and every one of us comes together to make this Center for Spiritual Living Asheville all that it was ever meant to be. It is a place of peace, a beacon of light, a tower of strength, and a fountain of wisdom that touches the lives of all who call it home. And so it is. Those of you watching online, you too can participate in this giving process by going to the donate button on our website. It'll take you right to PayPal, and you can be a part of giving and receiving all of life. And what I know is that every time we give anything, life experiences that abundantly. Our life demonstrates that which we give. It pours into our lives from multiple sources in ever-increasing amounts in love and joy. So we gave prosperity and abundance, and we live that now. We gave beauty, and we live that now. And we gave joy, and we live that now. And so I know that as we gave that gift, that essence that we are came with the gift, fills up the room from the floor to the ceiling, all between the walls. This air is rich and blessed with spirit as us. Prosperity, beauty, joy. I know that that energy touches us, every area of our lives. It awakens us to the presence of the divine as us now. I know that it's always here and always now, touching every one of us here today, everyone who has ever been here, and everyone yet to come. And so it is.